Hello there, ladies and gentlemen. This is Crazy Kitsune Gaming with another episode of Stellaris. And, I figure we pretty much know the drill by now. We have more systems that we are surveying. And I realize we actually have a colonizable world here. I'm gonna have to go back to the previous episodes and see why I didn't decide to colonize this immediately. Because really, once you get a world you can actually use, you should pretty much colonize it as soon as possible. Now, there are a few things to talk about when colonizing, and that is this whole summary page. So, in here we can see any planetary features we have, usually just whatever blockers are on it. Its actual planet class, the size of the planet, in which case 17 districts, which, is not a whole lot, but, hey, that's actually a bit smaller than our home world, actually. That's kind of tragic in reality. You can also see any planet modifiers. Now, most planets aren't actually going to have modifiers, but you can actually have some, and they're usually beneficial. And also the habitability. Now, habitability is an interesting little stat, and it actually depends on your main species' planetary preference. So here we can actually see the traits of our species, and our planet preference is actually one of those traits. So, essentially, whatever you choose to have your homeworld start as determines what this trait will actually be. In our case, it's continental preference, since we decided to start on a continental world. So, it means that we're going to have 80% continental habitability, and we will also get 60% habitability for the other two types of wet worlds. So it means that we are 60% on both ocean and tropical, and pretty much 20% across the board on everything else. So that kind of makes you wonder, what are the benefits of having higher habitability, and what are the punishments for having lower habitability? Well, right now we're at 80% habitability for this planet, since it's our preferred planet type. So, the only penalties that we're getting right now are 20% more population amenities usage. That's, a little devastating, since amenities aren't very fun to produce. 20% more population upkeep, so that means that our population will need more food and consumer goods. 10% less resources from jobs. And, of course, the most devastating, 10% less population growth speed. Now, right now, because we're at 80% habitability, these modifiers are pretty low. They're not actually going to hurt us that much, and we can still colonize the world without many issues. We will find planets that are going to be a little bit worse, like for example this ocean world. It's still a wet world, but it has a habitability of only 60. So now all of the negative modifiers are basically doubled. They're cranked up to 40 and 20% respectively. So really, you want to be colonizing planets at, in my opinion, around 70% habitability. If they're reaching that point, then you are going to be getting a return on your investment of colonizing it fairly quickly. So, in this case, we are going to go ahead and colonize it. Now, how do you actually colonize a planet? Well, it's pretty simple. Once you actually have the planet in your borders, then you can just hit this colonize button, and then decide to choose whichever species you want to colonize the planet. Since we only actually have one in our nation, then it's not really an issue. So, basically, by pressing this button, then we will automatically start building a colony ship in our nearest shipyard. Now, if you want to, you can actually build colony ships earlier by going to the shipyard and building one here. And it can be a good choice sometimes if you have the economy to do it, as they do take an entire in-game year to build. So sometimes having an extra colony ship sitting in reserve isn't necessarily a bad thing. So then, let's go ahead, colonize the planet. We are going to build a colony ship. And now you can actually name the colony. Now, the good thing is, depending on which name list that you chose in the Empire creation screen, and if you don't know what that screen is, I have made an entire video on it. Well, one of the things we talked about in that video is the different name list you can go through. And they will actually also give you a different list of random planet names, like Star Root or New Beginning. Or, of course, you can just, you know, go ahead and name the colony yourself, which is what we're going to do in this case. So, there we go. No, not an extra S, an A. There we go, that's a reasonable name, Kitsua. Yeah, that goes off the tongue decently. So, there we go, it's named, and now, if we go to our shipyard, yep, there it is, we're building a colony ship, and it's eaten up the resources from our overall stockpile. So, a colony ship does cost 200 food, consumer goods, and alloys to make, so they are actually quite expensive compared to our corvettes and construction ships and science ships that all only take 100 corvettes. 100 corvettes? No, 100 alloys to make. So yeah, colony ships, they're quite expensive. So then, with that out of the way, let's go ahead and get a new scientist for this science ship over here. I can't remember if I wanted him to research the anomaly there, or if I wanted him to start surveying. Thing is, I know the anomaly there is one that's going to take a long time, so I'm probably just going to have him survey the Cyrama system. So, new leader, and you may notice that the leader cost is slightly bigger than when we first started, and that is because the cost of initially hiring a leader actually scales with how many leaders you have. I think it will cost about 50 extra unity per leader that you already have. So do keep that in mind. As you start getting more and more scientists and, you know, more and more generals and admirals and other leaders like that, you're going to need to increase your unity production more and more, not only to pay their unity upkeep, but just to initially hire them in the first place. Alright then, Petals of Burgundy, you're going to go and survey Cyrama. Alright then, and let's move this construction ship over here into Biriahynia. Yeah, sure. You go do that. Now then, how is our capital doing? Okay, so we've just about finished this mining district. Now, what do I want to build after that? I suppose another industrial and city district. Because, honestly, we're going to need to be making more alloys and consumer goods pretty soon. So, yeah, get one of those going. And, of course, the city district will give us another building slot, which we're going to need fairly soon. We are going to start using these up. So once we have the minerals for that, which shouldn't take too long, we'll start queuing it up. Yeah, and we also don't really have as many populations as I would like. Come on, Fenzo, shag faster. We need more of you. Alright then. Now, another thing to mention. Building these outposts that you actually make do have a extra sensor range. Yeah, I'm pretty sure, yes, in their stats, +1 to sensor range. So before we even had this science ship over here in the Cyrama system, we were actually seeing that, and that's because any system that is adjacent to one of your outposts, you will actually be able to see because of their extra sensor range. So that is a neat little thing. Not always the most helpful, but it is good at letting you know what's actually in a system without spending a science ship to actually... Uh-oh. Strange sensor readings. Ooh, okay. I see. This planet emits strange magnetic waves, quite unlike anything we have seen so far. Almost as if it is trying to communicate with us. It is only logical to investigate this unusual phenomenon. We may have just encountered an extraordinary example of life on a planetary scale. Yeah, that's interesting and everything, but that's gonna take like 1,000 days. 1,080 days. We'll come back to that on a later date. Okay, so, remember, add this to the bucket list. Research gas giant when we have the time. Also, is our construction ship there yet? Just about. There he goes. Yeah.
System survey complete.
Also, system survey complete. Okay, good. So we do actually have this system surveyed and everything. So why don't you go over and survey this system real quick while you're at it? Now, something I feel like I should mention real quick, it's not really an issue because we haven't seen any other nations yet, but when you start meeting them, then you're going to start having some issues getting systems before they do. So what you can do, we can't do it in this case because there's an actual planet we want here, is you can actually close your borders to other nations you meet basically instantly. So what it means is you can actually lock off systems so that they will never be able to grab them because your borders are closed to them, which means that you can actually save up on influence and use it later to grab, you know, specific choke point systems and stuff like that. Just something to keep in mind. Not really important now, but it will be later. So we do have, yep, everyone's doing something. We are exactly a third of the way done with this colony ship. And we are slowly working on this industrial district. Yeah, I also realize industrial districts take how much time to make? 480 days. Yeah, and the resource districts only take 240 and 30 minerals. I mean, I suppose it makes sense since both city and industrial districts are probably some of the most important. Still irritating nonetheless. Uh-oh, scientists gained traits. Despite recent skill improvements, owing to accumulated experience, scientist Rizom of Yellow seems to be approaching the limits of his abilities. So, Rizom of Yellow gains the Arrested Development trait, granting the following effects. Leader level cap negative 2. Oh, well, isn't that just wonderful? Rizom, where are you? Okay, so, yeah, as your scientists level up, they do have their, you know, nice little starting trait here, like the expertise in Voidcraft, which is quite helpful for engineering. But they can also sometimes gain negative traits, like this arrested development. So yeah, that means that they are stuck at level 3 once they hit that. So that's pretty awful. Now, the good thing is there's a lot of ways to increase the leader level cap, but yeah, that kind of sucks. Now, the good thing about Arrested Development is I think that you can actually stack enough leader level cap to get rid of it, but man, yeah, that's rather unpleasant. Thank you very much, Stellaris. And also, Stock of Ebony has leveled up. Well, good for you. You're doing far better than the other guy, that's for sure, because at least you didn't gain any negative traits. Alright, construction ship. I need you to go ahead and build that. Ah, look at that. Only 67 influence. See, everyone, expansion is wonderful. Expansion is just great. I mean, yeah, I'm sure its actual return on investment numbers aren't that great, but, you know, more population growth speed and 10% less influence cost. Expansion is great, everyone. I don't know what you're all talking about. Anyway, there we go. You're building that up. How is our research doing, I wonder? Oh,
system
it's...
System survey complete.
Okay. More signs of precursor activity, this time in the Jundius system. Again, we're going to leave that for later. Although it's good that we're getting so many of them in our borders so quick. Ooh, Cyrama has 10 minerals. That's actually pretty good considering we're building an industrial district as we speak and we're gonna have to get those minerals back somehow. So yeah, our research, kind of dreadful, and that's why I'm wanting to build in an industrial district so that we can have more consumer goods to do more research. Because really, researcher jobs are pretty much the most important.
Construction complete.
Well, construction complete. There we go. Good to hear. What do I want you to build first? Well, I was just complaining about our tiny research, so... Build the research station on the big, beautiful blue star. And now I will get this planet ready to colonize. Ooh, and it has a modifier. Okay. So, planetary features... Ooh, 5 of them. And remember, because our nation has the... environmentalist civic, then basically any blocker we find is like this mini administrative building. So, we actually want more of these. So yeah, that's only -5 districts. So this is essentially a size 19 planet. So it's actually one bigger than our capital. But also it has, ooh, one of my favorites, hazardous weather. This world suffers from unstable weather patterns, with violent storms frequently appearing out of nowhere to wreak havoc on the surface. Now that does sound utterly awful, and in some ways it is. That's -10% habitability, -5% happiness. But also, it gives us 20% more energy credits from jobs, and also +4 max generator districts. So, this would actually be a nice world to have a lot of generator jobs. I quite like that. It would also make a good farming world, but don't really need one yet. Let's go ahead and, well, get another colony ship ready. Actually, we're still building the last one, though, aren't we? Yeah, see? See, guys? You know, building colony ships early can be a good choice sometimes. Not that I really could have done anything, because I've kind of been swamped building science ships. In fact, I need you to get back to work, please. There you go. Thank you. But yeah, if you have the opportunity, definitely build your colony ships a bit earlier. Otherwise, you run into issues like this. What do I want to name you? Are we gonna get any decent ones from the random name generator? New Light. You know what? Let me modify that a bit. If this is gonna be an energy world, then how about this? There we go. See, that's better. Sparking light. That's more fitting. Perfect. Alright then. So now we will have, yeah, 2 colony ships in the queue. Oh wow, our alloy budget is not happy with us right now. I started this episode with like 400 of the things. Now it's like 151. Ouch, I guess? Alright, so what is the Rimnok system saying? This is just Gas Giant Prime. Yeah, we have 4 Gas Giants in here. And the occasional Asteroid and Baron world. That's... yeah, okay. Well, I mean, it has 4 energy, so, like, who am I to complain? Not as good as this system with its 10 minerals in it. Construction complete. Ooh. Okay, construction complete. Okay, now, speaking of minerals, I want you to come over to this asteroid and build its mining station. Now, each of the different stellar bodies you can run into actually has a higher chance of having a specific resource. Asteroids in particular are pretty nice because they have a higher chance of minerals and also a higher chance of alloys, which are pretty much one of the most important resources in the game, and usually you need to process them inside of your industrial districts. So getting them just straight from an asteroid is pretty dang nice if you have that opportunity. Okay, what do we want to go next? We've already grabbed the less Starbase influence cost. And yes, we've grabbed colonization feather, so... You know what? Let's start breeding faster. We need more Fenzo. Lots more, in fact. Alright then.
System survey complete.
Whoop, okay. The system has been surveyed. What a nice little system. Not very pretty to look at, being just barren worlds and asteroids, but hey, it gives us resources. So this is the, it's a practicality system. It cares about efficiency. There we go. You start surveying that. Ooh, Rimnok is also a good system. It has both energy and minerals. Kasairama only has like 2, this has 4. So, less minerals, but it makes up for that with energy. And it still has a decent amount of gas giants, so there could be something else in here.
Research complete.
Aha, yes, our first bit of research is now complete. Biodiversity studies. So now we've completed a bit of research, so that we'll be getting more research from our researchers. Alright, so what do we want to go with next? Oh, actually all of these are good choices. So we have Grand Defense Planning. So that would give us 2 more naval capacity from our soldier jobs. Now we don't have any soldier jobs yet, but we will eventually. And it also gives plus 33% defense army damage. The first time I played Stellaris, I actually went with this basically immediately. It was the first choice given to me. Hindsight is 20/20, and that actually wasn't the best, especially right now when we don't actually see any other nations to actually invade us to make defense armies helpful. So, eco-stimulation, that's also pretty good. It's 20% more food from farmers, and also 10% more food from Starbase constructions. Now, you may be wondering, oh, what Starbase constructions give you food? How is that helpful? We haven't seen that yet. Well, we actually do. Hydroponics farming. Now, this is a very nice little piece of technology. Hydroponics farming in a controlled environment allows for crops to be grown in climates where farming would normally be impossible. So, hydroponics farms, it unlocks a building for you that gives you 2 farmer jobs. Now, that in itself is pretty cool, because this means that you can essentially use your building spots how you would normally use agriculture districts. But, as we've seen, sometimes planets aren't particularly big, so this is pretty good for that type of situation. However, even better than the new building that we get, we also get the hydroponics bay. By dedicating a section of this starbase to hydroponic farming, the station will be able to feed itself and even export excess produce to other systems. So yes, it means that you can actually use your building slots on the stations, like here, the buildings. So instead of a crew quarters, now we're not gonna like dismantle this or anything yet, but it means on any new starbase, we could use that building slot for a hydroponic bay, thereby giving us 10 more food, because that's how much they give, And that actually gets a little bit better because of technologies like eco-simulation. Now, 10 food isn't really that much, and I think our farmers actually already produce almost double that. Yeah, 23 food for an actual farming district. And each individual farmer is giving, 11. So already, hydroponic spays don't look that good. But the thing is, to actually get food from those farmers is requiring a population working that farmer job. Hydroponic spays don't require anything other than a station, and stations are far easier to build than growing new populations. So, this is actually a really good technology, and I think I'm going to go for it. But then again, this other technology here, the planetary unification, is also pretty good because, I get a lump sum of unity, you get more monthly unity. But the thing is, because of our origin, the prosperous unification, you know, the default origin that you start with without any DLCs, then this is basically always going to show up. Hydroponics farming might not show up next time, so we're actually going to start researching it right now. 50 months remaining to research that. We'll fix that soon enough, don't you worry. So next up, we'll learn the administrative AI, which ironically will actually help us research the hydroponics thing a little bit faster. Okay. Now then, this industrial district is about done, so now let's queue up the city district. Perfect. Alright then. So back to surveying systems. Hello there! Two science ships in the same system. And fun fact, you can actually assign two different science ships to survey the same system, and they will survey it quicker. Now, you can't have two science ships on the same stellar body and have it be researched quicker, but you can have two different science ships surveying each of the stellar bodies in the system, meaning that they'll both get it done a bit quicker. We're not quite to that point. Our shipyard is a little bit swamped with, Habitable World Survey. We now know without a doubt that a thriving biosphere is not something unique to our den. Both the scientific community and the public at large are eager to learn more about the various forms of alien life found throughout the galaxy. Efforts to catalog the life forms we encounter are already underway, but our xenobiologists have urged us to focus our planetary survey efforts on habitable, life-bearing worlds. So yeah, this will send you down a little bit of an event chain that sometimes you can complete, and sometimes you can get stuck not being able to do it forever. So this will begin the habitable worlds survey event chain. So essentially what they'll want you to do is survey 8 habitable planets. Now, in order to get this done, you will need a few more science ships because over time, the other nations that spawn in the galaxy will survey more and more of the space, and you need to be the one to actually survey it first. If you actually conquer a planet from another nation, that doesn't count because it's already considered surveyed. So, you could also not decide to go down this event chain and say, we have more important matters to focus on, which does give you a decent little burst of unity. Now, we are having, I think, about 3 science ships right now, so our odds of getting this done are pretty decent. And if you do manage to get it done, then you'll gain a hefty chunk of energy credits and also society research. Okay then. So, you've gotten this system completely grabbed, so now I want you to grab, I think Cyrama, although we do have a planet here? What is it? It's a continental world. Okay. Still gonna grab Cyrama first, but then Jundius is the next thing on the agenda. Ah, but then Rimnok has a lot of minerals and energy. Influence really is the main bottleneck when expanding. That's a little bit annoying. Now, currently, yeah, our shipyards keep getting swamped by these colony ships, and that's gonna get even worse when we have this planet within our borders. And it's a size 19. That's actually nice and respectable. But I'm actually thinking I want to build another station at some point. Now, the thing is, we have a very small station cap. So, yeah, we can effectively support a total of 3 upgraded star bases. Our outposts do not count towards the cap. And, yeah, exceeding the starbase capacity will increase their cost. Now, you can increase it by having more owned systems. I think you'll get 1 extra starbase capacity for every 10 systems you have. Right now, we only have 4. So that is a long way down the line, but getting potentially... The science ship FFR Drifting Leaf has encountered a hostile alien vessel's fleet in Condora and is currently attempting to invade them. Evade them. We're not invading them yet! And also, we have made first contact with an unknown entity. Alright, contact report. Enigmatic spacefarers. The Free Fenzo Republic has finally encountered fellow wanderers among the stars. Despite their intentions being unknown and potentially even hostile, oh, we already know they're hostile, the atmosphere on Auradon following the report from our contact fleet can be best described as rapturous. Okay then. So yes, encounter in Condora. We have made first contact with mysterious aliens in the Condora system. For now, we have codenamed them the Lambda aliens, until we can find out more about them. If they possess a language, we must decipher it in order to establish communications. So this will start the first contact process with the Lambda aliens. So let's pause real quick and see what we actually have here. Okay. Hello, mining drones. So, what we found here isn't technically another nation, however, it will in some ways act like one. So these are mining drones. So essentially what they do is they will sort of go around and spread themselves to other systems by mining certain things that they've found. So they will sort of spread out and they will attack anything that gets absurdly close to them. You can technically skirt around them if you want to, but because they're basically right on top of this molten world, we'll never actually get the system fully surveyed. So that's annoying, we just have a massive mining drone fleet here. Yeah, they have a fleet power of 1,700. We have like 114, we can't take that on right now. Now, in order to actually see more about them and tell what they are, then we will need to go through a first contact process. You do that by either coming down to here in your notifications bar at the bottom, or you can go to the situation log and actually see the event from there. So, in order to actually do a first contact event, you need to assign an envoy to learn more about them. Now, you usually start with only 2 envoys, but we have about double that because we are a fanatic xenophile. So yeah, we just have buckets of these guys lying around, so it'll actually be nice to get one of them to stretch their legs a bit. So, the thing about envoys is, unlike 90% of the leaders in the game, they don't have stats and they don't even have a unity upkeep. So, you really don't have to worry about them. They can die of old age, and then the game will just instantly replace them, so... yeah, let's just go ahead and assign Petals of Gold. So, now that we've got this going, then we will slowly learn more about them. Now, as for the science ship, what is it going to do? Well, because we have set it to the evasive stance, then it is currently evading hostiles, so it is entering the hyperlane to the Rimox system, and it will get there in about 14 days. Ooh, that's very interesting. Crystalline asteroids, so these things are very rare. A large asteroid covered in some kind of crystalline outcroppings. So this is basically a special version of the normal asteroids you find that have a higher chance of having minerals and also a resource known as rare crystals. Now, they're sort of a late game resource, but if we actually have any here, probably not because I'm never that lucky, but if there are some here, then we'll definitely want them. So then, why don't you go ahead and get your tail out of the system? There we go. Now, that does sadly get rid of their order, so they will just head to the system's star and then call it a day. So we'll have to tell them to go and survey another unknown system. Okay then. Now, the thing about mining drones is where you find one of their fleets, you have the very scary possibility of finding even more of them. So, yeah, need to watch out for that. So, we're definitely not going to change any of our science ship's stance anytime soon, that's for sure. Because it means there is every possibility there's more of them.
Research complete.
Okay, Mizar. You know, that's funny, the first time I actually played, I actually had a system pretty much exactly like this. It had a pulsar, although it only had like one barren world. So now I get two this time. So we've researched the administrative AI, and now we have, not really the best choices in the world. Now, there is the argument that, oh, well, you know, we've found some hostile entities now. Shouldn't we start researching blue lasers? No, because mining drones can't actually take you over. How mining drones work is they will spread to any system that hasn't been taken by another nation. So, all of these systems here, like Burrenhia, Rundor, Beta Curvy, and Furix, they can't ever come into these systems, so we don't really need to worry about that. But they could potentially grab Rimok, they could grab Cyrama, Jundius, or Mizar. So that is something to watch out for. And yes, if they grab any of those systems, sure, we'll grab the blue lasers, but for now, it would probably be better to grab something like field modulation. Also, we have this fusion power. So essentially, this is a power generation tech. Now, kind of like the blue lasers, this is mostly for military. It will lead you down more technologies later. Yeah, it will lead to further advancements in several different fields. But for now, we're just gonna go with field modulation. That will give us more energy credits from our technicians and more energy credits from our star-based constructions. So all the little mining stations for energy that we have lying around. Funnily enough, it's also exactly 50 months like the hydroponics farming was at the beginning. All right then. Furk Station, are you about done with your colony ship? Just about.
Building a new home.
Ooh, speaking of colony, the first Fenzo colony. Ooh, that rolls off the tongue a lot. Our colony ship has gently touched down at the mouth of a large river delta on one of the several continents that can be found on Kitsua. This temperate, forested region will serve as an ideal first landing site. The ship has been permanently converted into the administrative headquarters of the new settlement, and its reactor core is in the process of being removed so it may serve as the colony's temporary power source. Hundreds of small tents and prefab shelters have sprung up around the former starship's massive hull as colonists begin to disembark in large numbers. The first Fenzo city on an alien world. Alright then, a great day for the Free Fenzo Republic. So that has given us 303 engineering research. Good. Now, just because our colony ship has landed, we don't actually have the planet yet. We'll need to go through a colonizing planet process. So yeah, that will be done in about 2 years. Three. Time, basically. And sadly, a non-zero amount of time. So yeah, the colony ship does get destroyed once you actually colonize the planet. Which is a little annoying, and that's why you sometimes want to build some of them in preparation. So then, we actually have our first colony getting about ready to be done. So then, that's a nice little thing to finally have going. Now, at first, when you colonize a planet, it's not very economic, but later on, because that is another place where you're growing populations and a place where you have more jobs, they are overall a very good thing to have. Oh yeah, also, when you colonize a planet, then it will actually show your nation's symbol in the system. Ooh! The spectral clockwork. The study of pulsars seems to be an endless source of insights for our scientists, but rarely exhibit any signs of overtly dangerous phenomena. This makes the recent reports on Mizar all the more concerning. An initial scan revealed that the pulsar, in addition to its regular electromagnetic beam, is emitting a separate beam at a limited wavelength, which is only visible in the same system, at shorter and shorter intervals. According to initial calculations, the interval between these pulses will reach zero at date 2300. What occurs then is open to speculation, but the lack of explanation for the pulse has instilled an almost superstitious fears in those who studied it. Alright, so we must be watchful. We will have answers eventually. Now, I do think this is a DLC event, but it's not a particularly beneficial one, so I don't think it's going to be anything game-breaking for the average person. Alright then, so you are officially building in Cyrama. Very good. And Firk Station is finally done with the colony ships. Now I'm instantly going to stick another science ship in the queue. Yeah, I bet our shipyard workers are very angry. Just when they thought they were done. No. There's always more to do. Alright then. So now you can build all your mining stations there. Wasn't that too energy a moment ago? Did the star get better? Is it appreciating the embrace of our borders? Is it happy to work for us? I guess we're just a very charismatic nation. Alright then, speaking of charismatic, we need the charismatic stock of brown to go and survey more systems. Okay then, so this here is going to be the choke point system. So from this system, then we can set up a single starbase and be able to block off most forms of entry into our borders. Ooh, and Drimok actually got a bit better. It has an even amount of energy and minerals. So it's perfectly balanced, as all things should be. And also, Aneria, how system are things going complete. Here? Well, we surveyed a system. It's not the one I was looking at, but oh well. Oh yeah, also, something to talk about with pulsars. They actually have effects. Yeah, when you look over the system, then it will say, you know, the name of the system, Mizar, unclaimed system. Our intel level on it is full because we've surveyed it. It's a pulsar, and it's providing environmental hazards. In this case, 100% shield nullification. So, usually our ships would actually have both hull points, armor points, and also shield. And as you can see, you usually have a little blue bar on top of the main rusty one that you have. See, if we go over here and look at the science ship here, yeah, we have an extra blue health bar on top, representing our 100 shield hit points. But because this system basically nullifies the shield entirely, then yeah, we're not seeing that. So it can make pulsars very interesting systems to fight in. They're also actually pretty good, and I may invest a little bit into building defensive structures there, because what you can do is build structures specifically made to not run with any shields, so that you can actually have an easier time fighting off any enemies, since the AI will always want a little bit of shield, and in fact, even players will, because 90% of the systems out there aren't pulsar systems, so they can be very good defensively. Kinda sad that it's not the choke point system then. Not really sad, just annoying. So, first contact event pending. Something has happened in one of the first contact investigations we are currently undertaking. So then, Space Automata. We have discovered a new life form in Condura. Although calling it a life form may be incorrect, the entities appear to be fully automated mechanical drones, built exclusively for some unknown industrial purpose. Observations will continue, but since it's likely that these machines are programmed with defensive protocols, it would be prudent to tread lightly. So, yes, keep looking but use caution. The first contact process advances. Now, a few things to talk about with the first contact process. The first thing here on this list is the breakthrough chance. So right now, there is a 0% chance that the current phase will end in success. However, the phase has a 60% chance of granting insights, which increases the chance of future phases' success. We need 5 more insights or envoy skill points before we will have a chance at succeeding at this phase of the investigation. So essentially, what this means is the current countdown that's going on isn't actually going to result at all in us completing this stage of the first contact event. But as more time goes on, then you'll get higher and higher chances. There's also the difficulty to talk about. So basically, the difficulty is essentially what it says on the tin. It will reduce your likelihood of getting successful results at the end of an investigation phase. So, yeah, and each chapter in a first contact investigation can have a different difficulty value. Now, there's also skill bonus. The skill bonus will increase the likelihood of getting successful results at the end of an investigation phase. A country's skill bonus is increased by successfully completing first contact processes and by improving its code-breaking ability. This bonus increases breakthrough chance. So essentially, the breakthroughs are this up here, your chance of just completing it right then and there. So actually, doing these first contact events with things like these mining drones, and in fact, there are 2 other types of entities you can run into that act a bit like the mining drones. So it can be good practice to actually make first contact with another nation before they make first contact with you. Because whoever completes the first contact will get a bit more influence than the other nation that didn't complete it first. So yeah, it can be very helpful in expanding to just get these done as soon as possible. And since the mining drones in particular can't actually do a first contact on you, then it means that they are basically just a little chunk of influence that will come later down the road. And of course, there are also insights. Insights represent how much information you have uncovered in relation to a chapter in a first contact investigation. Insights increase the breakthrough chance. And of course, anytime you don't get the breakthrough, then you usually get more of those insights. Now, there is one more thing here that says unknown. So we do not yet know how these aliens will respond to our contact. We kinda do, though, is the thing. So essentially, this kind of signifies, based on your information you've gathered from the first contact, how they're actually going to treat you. Now, here it says unknown, that's kind of a steaming pile of BS, because we already know that they're going to try and attack us. So, yeah, that is the first contact thing. Mostly, any events that you get that aren't the actual completion of the first contact are basically going to sum up to, hey, we haven't discovered anything yet. So, yeah. That is kind of first contact explained. A little bit annoying how they do it, because you just get all of these events before you've actually made contact. So you get really excited thinking, ooh, we know about them now. And then you read the events and then, we don't know anything. Now what we do know is everything in the Aneria system. So that's some nice knowledge to have. However, it's not enough. Stock of honeydew, go and get us more knowledge, please. Alright then, so we have Isseus. Oh, that's two purple stars. Well, that's just pretty. Also, do I have you both surveying the system? You're surveying Isseus? And you're surveying Isseus. You know what? It's a choke point system. You two have fun. It can be good bonding to survey a system together. Alright, Eberomachus. So this is going to be our other choke point system.
Research complete.
I believe. Unless there's no other hyper lanes in this little section here, but the odds are this star will connect to this one. That's what the odds are. Maybe we'll be lucky. Alright then, so 10% more mining station output, and we've unlocked the Nebula Refinery. Which is a nice little building to have. It's kind of like the, it's like a mineral version of the hydroponics bays. However, you need to actually build them on a station that has a nebula in it. So they're a bit harder to actually make. So then, we can improve our Corvette hulls, or actually increase our Corvette build speed and decrease their build cost. This is actually a pretty decent technology, and I would usually say the Corvette hulls are better, but since the Corvette patterns are actually a little bit cheaper, it can be better overall. However, we haven't actually found any nations yet, and we don't yet have any mining drones blocking off our expansion, so we're just going to grab 20% more minerals and 10% more minerals from Starbase constructions. Alright then. Now, how's our homeworld doing? It's still building that city district. Okay. Somewhat annoying, but it'll be done fairly soon. Soon enough for my taste. And, oh, you know, we do actually have a nebula. Ooh, more signs of precursor activity. Okay. So, again, don't research it yet, but let's actually see in the situation log. Yeah, precursors, the Voltaeum. So, I'm pretty sure there's a way to look at more of that. Well, I know that we have three of their precursor anomalies within our borders. Okay, yeah, there we can see it. So, signs of precursor activity, and again, signs of precursor activity. So, you can see here that you need six of their artifacts recovered. Each of these signs of precursor activity will give you one. So, we have essentially gotten three of the six that we need. So, that's pretty good, all things considered. Oh yeah, and we have this new science ship. I completely forgot about you. Maniacal. Well, that's a trait better for researchers, but oh well. We just need somebody to crew the science ship. So, why don't you go and... why don't you try surveying all the way out here? Because by the time you get here, these two will probably be done. Alright then. So what is this system saying? Wow. Lots of different stellar bodies. Oh, they're all making this nice little row here. That's kind of cute. No habitable planets, unfortunately. And so far, no resources, but the system is still pretty young. It still has a lot of chances to have something that we need. Now, how about the other systems? Well, Isseus is doing pretty decently. I mean, following the rules of Cyrama and Rimok, like, we like systems like this. Although, Mizar is actually probably the best we've seen so far, giving us engineering research. Okay, more first contact. Aha! Reports of the deep space drones previously encountered have been investigated closer. The drones appear to be workers and custodians of an autonomous orbital mining operation established millennia ago, and soon abandoned by all but the drones themselves, judging by the state of the processing equipment. The drones possess powerful mining lasers, and make obviously threatening, if not outright hostile, overtures towards free vessels when approached. They may only be old drones, but they should be kept under close watch by the Free Fenza Republic. Alright, understood. So, these first contact events are a little bit special because they also issue you a special project. Now, we do get R30 influence, so we're very happy to have our influence.
They can talk, and they want to talk to us.
I don't think they can actually talk, but you know, I like your enthusiasm, their advisor voice. So yes, we've finished our first contact procedure. Now, as for the actual special project we get, it is the drone study, which will take us 73 months. God, that's brutal. So, task a science department with collecting and collating data relating to the ancient mining drones. So, by doing this, then you will get one of two options. When you complete it, you'll be presented with the choice to either get bonus damage against the mining drones, or sort of learn from the mining drone techniques and get more resources from your mining stations. Now, you definitely want to go with the latter. I'm pretty sure it's 33% more damage against mining drones. And, you know, with them casually running around with fleets over 1,000, that does sound good. But eventually, you will overpower the mining drones just by building up more military and researching more technology. Speaking of researching more technology, we can finally get our first research lab going. Very good. And also, we really, really want to get this Octothon monument down. So yeah, this is the building that, depending on your ethics, has different effects. So, this is going to increase naval capacity and population upkeep reduction. And, of course, the governing ethics attraction. So yeah, that's going to make our populations 10% cheaper. So I think, essentially, what this is going to result in is reducing their food and consumer good upkeep. So yeah, we're kind of fans of that, aren't we? Now that does eat up all of our minerals and building slots, but that is going to be a very helpful boon to our planet. Speaking of planet, we are over halfway to colonizing the planet, but we have made first contact with mysterious aliens in the Ebermacambus system. For now, we have codenamed them the Yode aliens until we can find out more about them. Interesting! Now then! This is an actual nation we found because they haven't started off immediately hostile. And to confirm that, okay, no. So, this is actually the other type of a non-nation thing that you can make first contact with. So far we've been quite lucky. I mean, I would be a bit surprised if we found a nation with us in this cluster, but it wouldn't be too outlandish for Stellaris. This is the exact kind of game that would put a nasty nation right beside you. Believe it or not. So these are the Tianqi space whales. So these things are, well, basically space whales. They sort of just float around space and pretty much do nothing. Now, some of the more nasty nations out there will go around and kill these things, and it's sort of a good way to tell the type of nation you run into if you've made first contact with vessels, and then they come and attack these. You know you're probably going to be at war with that nation before you've even completed the first contact. So yeah, mostly the Tianqi, they're just these friendly little whales. The only thing they do is sometimes they attack pirates. So really, they're nothing but a benefit to have in your borders. So then, yes, we will assign the envoy. Well, Petals of Gold, you did the last one, so, Rizom of Red, why don't you do the next one? Also, did you two switch names? You look more like a Rizom of Ebony, but instead you're Rizom of Red. You look like Rizom of Red would be more fitting for you, but yet your name is Rizom of Ebony. Okay, maybe they're brothers and they switched names or something. Alright, Rizom of Red, it's your turn. Have fun meeting the space whales. So yeah, these are just these big friendly blobs, really. All they really do is just go around your borders and sometimes take out pirates if they're feeling generous. Now, we don't actually have pirates yet, thankfully. But once we do, these guys will sometimes take them out. Sometimes. So I'm going to grab the Jundius system next, because we really want this planet over here. So Rimok, you're going to have to wait just a little while. Oh, Odysseus, okay. So what's happened here is, yep, the other one is already being surveyed, so this ship is just decided to take a break. Except not really, because now you're going to come down and survey this system. Alright then. So, I think I'm going to actually call it a day for now. We've made some first contact, we've found some friendly space whales, we've gotten some more territory and planets under our control. So yeah, I think it's been a fine episode so far. So yeah, that's gonna be it for today's episode. I hope you've all enjoyed it and learned a lot from it, because believe me, we're gonna be doing more. How did you get 16 minerals? You started with 10! How in the world did you do that? Anyway, if you enjoyed the episode, then definitely consider liking and especially subscribing, since I'm trying to get to 1,000 subscribers. And, you know, I kinda try to do this channel like a democracy. Whichever videos get the most subscribers, I'll do more videos on that game. So, if you want to see more Stellaris content, then, you know, vote by subscribing, because we are a democracy over here, and we like your opinion. Anyway, have a good day, and I'll see you next episode.